Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda and I'm joined today by Luke Clout of Australia and the Penrite Honda team. So, buddy, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
I think, no, we've had Dean. I was going to say you're our first international guest, but.
Yeah, okay.
But even so, man, you've been kind of trapped here. This is actually the quarantine week special. You know, we're responsibly spaced and we've got a little spit guard here, you know? So we're talking through glass. I don't know if you can see that on film, but quarantine happened and boom, no racing. You're here. Do you have did you have urges to fly back to Oz or are you just pumped being here?
Oh, it was definitely hectic at first, and when it all started, you know, obviously going downhill, we were arming and ahhing what to do. Like, my girlfriend was obviously, she went back to Australia because her visa expired, so she went back, and then I decided that I was going to stay, and then pretty much the international flights were getting cancelled, so I was like, you need to get on a flight. So she got on a flight and pretty much got here on the last day.
Oh, okay.
Because I decided that I was going to stay. So. She got here and, you know, obviously now there's no international flights into Australia or anything like that. So we're kind of stuck here.
Yeah. Hey, if she had been trapped here during the time the visa expired,
yeah.
What do you think would happen? Would they have just given it a pass because there's no way to get home to get?
Honestly, I'm not sure. Like, her 3 months, it expires in another 6 weeks. So. Uh-huh. We're kind of like monitoring it every day, every week, and there's flights that are coming back out of LA into Sydney, just getting people home. So yeah. As of now, she's okay, but I mean, everything's changing every day, so we've got to kind of monitor it a bit.
Okay, so man, obviously there's been plenty of really fast, successful Australian racers come to the AMA. It's funny though, because the one I talked to the most about it and the struggles and the journey and everything was obviously Hunter Lawrence.
Yeah.
And he was telling me his the sacrifices the family made back home and everything, and why Australia is good but limiting.
Yeah.
Do you share the same sentiments? Like, you just outgrew the country for motocross potential?
Well, yeah, like, obviously, you know, Hunter and Jet, you know, they did a little different. They obviously went to Europe yeah. And they sold everything. So, you know, they were definitely committed, which, you know, it's cool to see. And pretty much my parents kind of sacrificed a lot when I was younger. I came over here when I was 16. Mm-hmm. And they pretty much just got a credit card and, you know, maxed it out. And I was over at MTF riding and training and doing Loretta's and all the kind of the amateur stuff. And, mm-hmm. You know, we had some good results there. And there was times that, you know, we were talking to a few teams. It was pretty close to maybe having something happen, but
didn't you have something set up here in like 16?
Yeah.
Then you got hurt.
Yeah. So I obviously had that little amateur stint, and then it, you know, it didn't go that well. And then I went back home. I won some championships, and then the Mad Suzuki team that was around with Bishoya, mm-hmm. he was my teammate at the time, and I got on that, and that was like last minute. I think I rode a bike one day before A2 one mm-hmm. year, and then the next weekend I broke my femur, so it was kind of quick in and out for me. And then yeah, we're back here now, so it's good.
Yeah. All right, so was America always the goal for racing?
For me it was, yeah. Look, I always enjoyed supercross, and you know, we kind of did that as a younger age. My parents always wanted me to do the jumps and stuff like that, so I kind of liked that. And Europe, obviously, it's just an outdoor championship. So, mm-hmm. I've represented Australia in the Motocross of Nations twice and got to go and race in Europe. It was pretty cool, but it kind of wasn't for me. So, I always wanted to be back here and doing supercross.
Mm-hmm. What is the motocross scene in Australia like? Is it really popular? Or like, because country to country is different. Like, you know, I'm good friends with Akira Narita, and he says it's so small in Japan, and it really is. You'd think it'd be bigger because that's where...
Yeah.
Four of the bikes are made, but...
Well, like, I mean, you know, there is a series, but from when I started racing over there in, like, 2013, when I come back from America being an amateur, it was a lot bigger to where it is now. It's like, it seems like each year it just gradually declines almost. Like, the bike sales aren't that big, and it's just... It really isn't that popular of a sport. I think it's not advertised well. It's not very well known about it. So, like, example, you go to Walmart here and you know, I've been spotted before, and you know, I'm not even a really big rider. So, but I go to Australia, and you would, no one would know what a motocross rider or a supercross rider is.
You could walk around with your jersey on, and people would
100%.
Know.
So, like, if someone says, "Oh, what do?" You say, "Oh, I ride a motorbike." They're like, "Oh, do you do backflips?" That's instantly what they think.
Yeah.
They think we're part of the metal militia or something. So,
yeah.
But yeah, there's a sport there. But I mean, AusX Open, since Adam Bailey and all that guys have done that, you know, that's been really good. But the motocross scene's kind of been on a decline for a few years.
Yeah, that AusX Open, definitely a bucket list for me. You know, Anton went last year.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I want to go.
Yeah, that's a killer event, especially they've moved it to Melbourne now. I feel like being right in the city of Melbourne, and like Melbourne's just a real good city, and it's like big sporting city. So it's just a good vibe, and you know, they've done a really good job. So it's cool. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so for the country, for motocross to be so small in Australia, dude, you guys have pumped out like so many top level guys. I mean, all the way back to Jeff. Was Jeff Leask like the first guy, you think? I mean,
yeah, I reckon he would have been. Like that was a while ago, and he was more. Was he? He came with the AMAs and then with the GPs as well, didn't he?
Yeah,
he was. He would have to have been probably the first guy that came over and really.
But I mean, so many guys. You know,
yeah.
Leask, you know, Reedy, Craig Anderson.
Yeah.
Then all you guys right now. But
yeah.
Why? Why are you guys so good?
Like, I think it's like there's definitely potential in Australia for sure. Like, even when I obviously, you know, watch all the races and I know who the kids are and, you know, who the pros are and stuff like that. But, you know, you watch the kids and there's definitely potential there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the people that want to take it to the next step, you know, they... I know it's harder work in Australia to get to here, so it's not like, I feel like here if you're kind of brought up, it's kind of given to you a little bit, where in Australia if you want to make it, you've kind of got to really put 110% in and really be committed to making it work. So you know, even just flying over here, leaving your family, leaving your friends, leaving everyone behind, you know, like you just got to be committed to it. And Australia, it's definitely tough. So you know, I think we work hard to make it here, and then if we do get here, we try and work harder to stay here, you know what I mean? So, but it's cool to see so many Australians here.
Yeah. What is the biggest difference between moto here and moto home?
Just, it's
like, okay, for instance, here in Southern California,
yeah.
Right? You know, if we weren't in quarantine,
like yeah.
Today's Thursday,
yeah.
Right? You would have gone to Glen Helen,
exactly.
And it would have been jam-packed,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There have been a bunch of fast guys and a bunch of goons and
100%.
Everything, but there's so many people there,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Is a local track like that at home?
See, that's the difference. Like here, you know, you've got your Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. It's like designated days. You know where you're going, that's pro day.
Yeah.
You've got all the teams here. It's just set out, all right, we're going riding here. We've got trainers. In Australia, it's not like there's a few tracks here open or, you know, private tracks or whatever, but... It's just the magnitude of racing isn't as big at home. So you've only got, you know, X amount of pros in each state. So, and the teams are always based in different states and stuff like that. So it's just, and really like the commitment levels of the manufacturers and everything isn't as high as it is here. So like I would never have my team or even, I don't have a practice mechanic in Australia. So when I was riding in, you know, for Yamaha and when I was riding for KTM years ago, I'd go to the track by myself and just go and put my stopwatch on and all right, that's my 30-minute moto done and go home and wash my bike and just get ready for the next day. Where here it's like, all right, you've got to practice mechanic. All your days are quality riding. You can get your training in and everything. So the elevation's a lot higher here.
How did you get into riding? Is it like a family thing or?
Yeah, well, it's kind of weird because my mum and dad, like, they never rode bikes. Like, I don't even think my mum can really ride a push bike. And then, like, my dad, he'd try. He'd be one of them goons that you'd see at Glen Ellen on a Thursday. And he thinks he's the man. But my pop used to race, like, road bikes. So he kind of had that in his blood a little bit. And then I guess that's where I get it from because mum and dad, they're not that good. So they bought me a bike for my fifth Christmas and it was a shared bike for my brother and I. So we got that for fifth Christmas and yeah, we went there ever since. And I just remember my first memory is pretty much getting on a peewee and no one taught me what brakes were, or, you know, they just said, oh, go ride it, and just went straight through a barbed wire fence, and Christmas Day, I'm cut open and torn up, but, yeah, that was my memory, but, you know, that's ever since we've just gone from there.
So it's just always been what you wanted to do?
Pretty much, like, I was really good at soccer at one point, like, when I was younger, you know, that's a big thing in Australia, playing soccer on the weekends, just taking your family out, you know, we used to do that, and then I was really good, so I started playing for my state that I was that we live in, and it got to the point that we were doing three nights a week at soccer, and then I was riding in the afternoons, and then I'd do soccer on Saturday, and then Dad would have to go and get the bikes ready and ride Sunday, and he just said to me one day, he just looked me in the eye, he said, mate, choose one right now, I don't care what it is, and he said, I don't care, and I said, all right, I'll just do bikes, and then the soccer ball was kicked away, and ever since we've just been riding.
And then soccer coaches hate other sports, right?
They always used to say that to me. Oh, because I was quite a good player, you know. You don't need that. You're going to get hurt, and you're going to miss out. You're going to miss out on playing, and the team's going to be upset. And it was just trying to do this psychology on me. But I'm glad we did racing.
So do you feel right now you made the right choice?
Yeah, I wouldn't change a thing. I've met some great people, and I've had some great memories, and I'm here in America living my dream, so it's cool.
And then it's kind of cool because it's a bit of a family affair for you, right? Because your brother is your mechanic?
Yeah, so he wasn't that great on a bike. So he thought, you know, the next best thing is to, you know, work on them. So he went and studied all that, and he kind of did all that for a few years, and then I went home after America, because he came over to America with me just to help. So he stayed here, and he actually worked for Moto Concepts back in 2012, I believe. And then I went home and raced for Yamaha and won some championships, and then he came home, and then it's kind of just been a thing. I've put in my contracts all the time that, you know, I want to have him with me, and, you know, we work really well together. So it's just kind of cool that I've got that confidence that, you know, my bike's going to be 100%. I don't even have to look at it. I know it's just going to be exactly how I want it. So it's cool.
Yeah, because a mechanic and a rider have to have a really strong bond, because you have to trust them. Your life is in his hands, essentially.
For sure. Like, you know, I've had some good mechanics over the time, and I've had some mechanics that aren't that great. But, you know, that relationship and trusting them 100% is, it definitely reflects on race day. Like, if you're going to the line and you've done 100%, the bike's 100%, like, it all makes pieces of the puzzle, you know, so.
Cool. Hey, Luke, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, but we'll be back for more with Luke Clout. Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by FMF Racing and OGIO Powersports. Joined today by Luke Clout from Australia. So your team is owned by one man.
Yeah.
Yuriev.
Yeah.
What's Yuriev's last name?
Yuriev Konski.
Okay, so I got to meet him at Anaheim 1 and talk to him, and he's like so passionate about it. He's like telling me about it, and I could see it almost seemed like his eyes were watering, you know, because he's so pumped to be here in the U.S. and have a team and everything, but that's crazy that a race team of that magnitude is owned by one guy. I mean, granted, we've got that here, but he's brought his whole race team to a different country.
Yeah, so I think Yuriev, he's like the most passionate guy in Australia. Like, everyone knows that. And He always just seems to get stuff done, and you know, it seems like it's a little bit far reach sometimes, and it's a little bit over the top, and but he makes it happen. So, you know, when he kind of approached me in Australia and was like, "Look, this is what I'm thinking," and that kind of got draw me there, and it was kind of weird because he was like, "Oh, this is what I'm thinking, but you know, it's not 100%." So I was like, "All right, well, let's do it." And then as the months went on, and you know, we got close to A1. It just all step by step started to happen, and you know, we started getting bikes like American Honda. They helped us out a lot, and yeah, just all the pieces of the puzzle started to happen. And what I think it was maybe a week before A1, he's like, "Yeah, I got a truck," and I'm like, "What do you mean?" Like, we were meant to go out of like a Sprinter van, and then he's like, "Oh, I got a semi now," and we're getting the wrap done at A1 and all this stuff. But when you know, A1 come around and the truck was set up and everything was done, it was a pretty surreal feeling, like obviously for him, but for myself to see what he'd kind of, you know, put together in, I think it was like 5 weeks, it was pretty crazy. So it was cool.
I think your truck has the best coffee machine.
Yeah. If you know, Reef, he loves coffee. So, man, he's into his coffee, but so am I. But I went to Intarsa this morning and he direct messaged me on Instagram. He's like, "I miss that place so much. I wish I was there." And I think he's probably crying.
Yeah. Okay. So you were originally supposed to race only the first half of the West Coast and then go back home, right?
Yeah.
But obviously you're trapped here, but you're also going to stay and finish out
the
season whenever it happens.
Yeah. So it wasn't even really originally meant to be the first six rounds. Like when we started speaking in November, it was like, "Look, this is what I'm thinking, and you know, we're going to go out of a Sprinter van," and then it's obviously elevated, but it was like, "We're going to do four rounds, and then you know, we're raced A1 and A2 and I'm like, "Reef, I'm not doing four rounds, like we're doing six, like San Diego's last round." He's like, "Oh, okay, no worries." And then you know, Oakland went around, got a top five, and San Diego was, you know, we were close to the top five of the six, and then he's kind of like, "All right, we'll make this happen." And we sat down and he agreed on, you know, letting me do the last four rounds. And obviously a lot's changed now with how everything's going with the coronavirus and stuff. But, you know, I was going to stay and do the last four anyway. And, you know, now I'll do the four anyway. So it's exciting.
So by staying here to race Supercross and passing on the Australian Championship, was it a financial sacrifice? I mean, could you have made more winning the title again?
Yeah, look, obviously I could have, you know, chose to say, "Hey, I'll just do the six and, you know, we'll go home and prep." And you know, at that time we would have thought we would have already been racing by now and we'll just go and make some money. And, you know, I'm not saying the Australian Series is easier or anything like that, but, you know, I had a good chance of winning rounds and winning the championship. So definitely there would have been, you know, more money there for sure. But I'm at the age now where this is kind of like the chance of a lifetime and the last chance really to do it. So I didn't really want to pass that away, and I'd, you know, sacrifice the money to, you know, live the dream, and hopefully we can just keep building and, you know, hopefully be a championship contender in a few years.
Yeah. So is this the dream in California right now? Like, how do you like life here?
Yeah, I enjoy it. So like, I just like being able to, you know, wake up and go and train and just ride, you know, that's the best thing, to be able to train. And obviously being with my brother and stuff like that and having my girlfriend here, it's really cool. So you know, just it's just every kind of Australian kid's dream is to be able to come here and race Supercross. So to be living that, it's pretty cool. And you know, I don't really want it to end, so I'm gonna give it 100%, and you know, I want to be here for years to come.
Okay, so you know, for motocross not being super popular or anything, like, I guess you're saying you're like not a superstar back home, but like, how did you get your girlfriend, dude? Like, Lauren is like, she a model or something, or like?
Yeah, apparently she is.
Huh?
Yeah, apparently she's a model,
right?
Yeah, apparently.
Yeah, like, but was it your supercross stardom that reeled her in?
Man, it was such a crazy story. Like, I was riding for Yamaha at the time, and we have a 6-week break in our series. And I got hurt at the final round of the round five, so into the break, and I had surgery on my hand. So Yamaha made me do these press things and go to, you know, bike shops and whatnot. So I had a massive argument with the team manager because I was just got cleared to ride on like the Friday, and he's like, "Nah, you need to go to this thing on the Saturday, and like all the tracks are open." I'm like, "I'm not going there. I'm going riding. Nah, you got to be there." So okay, went and did that, and anyway, there's a model there, you could say. Anyway, yeah, Lauren was there, and I don't know. She was just doing her thing. I was doing my thing, and then I don't know. We just kind of. Met on Instagram. I seen that she was there and it was her Instagram name, so I gave her a follow and a couple of likes, and then we just
Instagram has spawned many relationships, I think.
Instagram's a go-to, I think. It's the go-to.
Hey, so Australian rivalries, so like there's three Aussies in the 250 class now. Do you get along well with Jet and Hunter, or is there a little bit of a rivalry there? Or
no, I don't think there's any rivalries there. Like, obviously, I haven't really, you know, seen Jet and Hunter much, obviously, because, you know, they've been in Europe for, you know, the last, well, whatever, 3-4 years. And but, yeah, Jet and Hunter and, you know, we used to ride together all the time when we were younger, but that was, like, you know, probably 10 years ago now. And, yeah, but no bad blood. I think they've done really good, and you know, Hunter had awesome time over in Europe, and you know, Jet was good, and obviously how good Jet's going now, and you know, Hunter as well has had some injuries, but yeah, I'm just stoked to see Australians over here racing. So, and I think that's like when you're here overseas and you see someone from Australia, and you might not even know them, you've just kind of got like that, I don't know, like just how are you, mate, and it kind of just fuels that relationship. So, yeah, no, I'm stoked to see them over here and. You know, doing so good, so that's cool.
Okay, so let me ask you this. Is it like when you hear Americans like talk to you and say throw out the mate?
Yeah.
Is that like super poser? Oh. Or do you like that they're trying to talk like?
I think mate's all right, like that's okay. But I think when they're like, oh, the shrimp on the barbie and all that, it's like, come on, mate. What are you doing?
It's pretty bad that most Americans just think of Crocodile Dundee, right?
100%, that's the first thing they think of. I don't think they know much else other than that.
Yeah, I think, hey, are you friends with Bilko?
Yeah, I know Bilko, yeah.
Yeah, from back home? And
yeah, just even from when we've been over here, like I've just bumped into him a few times and then obviously been back home and stuff, but yeah, Bilko's cool. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Outback Steakhouse, total poser fake restaurant, 100%. Or is it pretty, it's not authentic at all?
Not at all. Oh, like a little bit, but not really. A little bit.
It's pretty funny because, you know, a lot of Japanese restaurants, like around here especially, aren't even owned by Japanese people. Yeah. So I know your feelings.
Like we've gone to Outback before and we're talking and I don't even think they know we're Australian. Like, you know what I mean? Like the Australian flag's up there and they just think, oh, it must be American or something, another person. But I mean, Outback's okay. We don't even have Outback at home. We've got like, I think one or two where I'm from and that's it. Like, and then here it's massive.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, hey, we're going to take another quick break, and we'll be back for one more with Luke Clout.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated, and it looks good.
To put our adventures on hold. But now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one. Be unstoppable. One goal, one vision.
Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Joined by Luke Clout today. Do you talk about your bike a little bit? Because I know we got to test it the other day with Alex Ray, and he honestly can't stop talking about it, how much he liked it and everything. But how much support do you guys get from Honda here? And I mean, obviously, Jamie Ellis at Twisted Development is building the engines, and he's a total badass.
Yeah, so Honda have been really good to us, like American Honda, obviously. They've sent, you know, a few bikes, a couple 250s, a couple 450s, and then obviously Honda Australia have, you know, made it work as well. So they've been really good, and, you know, we've had some parts budgets and things like that. So, you know, they've been real kind of open arms to the whole team, which is, it's been really good for us. So, and then obviously, you know, Jamie, that's where we're working out of. That's our workshop and stuff like that. So Jamie's been really good, and, yeah, he's been a really good dude from pretty much day one since I met him. He's been really nice, and he knows what he's doing on a bike. So he obviously, we got our bikes really late before A1. I think it was maybe like a week or two before A1 we had our race bikes. So he kind of did what he could with the time he had, and it was good. So we, you know, raced the first six rounds on what he had. And then when the six-week break happened, we kind of really knuckled down, and he come up with this package, and, you know, I did some testing, and he had multiple packages with different engines and everything like that. So he really went to work, and he's come up with something really good. So, you know, the next four races that we get to do, it's going to be really cool, because I'm excited to be on this bike. It's good.
Yeah. Obviously, in the 250 class, power is far more important than the 450s, because all 450s, I believe, make more than enough, right?
100%, yeah.
How much better is a bike at the highest level that you're racing than, say, a stock bike with a pipe?
Yeah, look, it's like you said, the 250 class is pretty much all about horsepower, and then comes with horsepower is reliability as well. Yeah. So, you know, there's that fine line, but our, like, the stock Honda was really good. I that's what I practiced on for pretty much my whole practice bike for the first six rounds was pretty much a stock bike with just an ignition and pipe on it. So that was, that got me through, and I was able to do, you know, heaps of supercross laps and jump all the rhythms and no worries at all. But, you know, now we've got a race bike. It's definitely night and day difference with the engine and all that type of stuff. It's a lot faster and the bottom end's better and stuff like that. But for a stock bike, because I come off a 450 and went back to a stock Honda, I was like, I didn't know what it was going to be like, and it took me a little bit to get used to it, but, you know, they're pretty good out of the box as well, so that's cool.
You know, what's funny is I didn't realize until the other day when we did the bike test that you guys were running Enzo.
Yeah.
Have you worked with my brother personally yet, or is it Will Decker?
No, I haven't. I haven't worked with you yet. Yeah, no, but I've heard about him, but I haven't worked with him though.
How has it been working with that shop?
Yeah, it's been good. We've had they've been really, really good to us, and Yareef's got it all sorted, and the suspension has been really good. And
but that was, he's not supporting you in Australia as well, is he?
No, I don't. That's kind of Yareef's department. I'm not sure how that worked, but he just kind of said, "Look, we're gonna get this through these guys, and this is how it's worked," and gone from there. So our suspension has been really good. Like, we made a setting up. I did a little bit of testing after a few rounds, and then we come up with a setting, and then I've just stuck with it the whole time. It's been really good.
Nice. So you got some parts on your bike, I think the wheels or the hubs and the triple clamps, it's an Australian brand?
Yeah, so they're called EZE, EZE products. So they do our triple clamps and our hubs and stuff like that, and that's all manufactured back at home. So he's out of Australia, obviously, and he's been sending all the stuff over, and you know, that's pretty cool stuff.
Yeah, it looks cool.
Yeah, it's all bling bits and stuff like that, but it looks cool.
Yeah, I like the clamps have that relief split in it.
Yep.
EZE.
Yeah.
That's a rapper.
EZE, yeah. Yes. No, he's been really good to us. He sends us kind of, you know, if we want a different offsets on the clamps. And obviously that clamp that you've seen that had the cutout, that's all new as well. He's kind of come up with that. So he's always kind of trying to make it a little bit better here and there. So it's cool to have that.
Yeah. Awesome. Hey, we talked about this a little bit when I saw you at the track, but like, what are your favorite things here? Like, what's your favorite restaurant to eat here? I know it's not Outback.
It's not Outback, no. But I don't know. We were, since quarantine, obviously, we've been really good and been eating it at home and, you know, making our food. But we were smashing some outs, like going out a little bit. But probably I like Texas Roadhouse. It's probably one of my favorites.
Really?
I just like a good steak. So that's pretty good. And I don't know, there's just too many to choose from. Like, I can't believe the amount of fast food that's here. It's crazy.
Too much fast food.
Way too much. And I don't eat that, but it's crazy to think when you're just driving past, it's like at home, it's McDonald's and KFC and that's it.
Yeah. Okay, so who cooks at home?
Lauren has a little bit of a go. I don't cook, but the lady that we're staying with, she gets on the tools pretty good. She's good.
Ah, okay. What do you do for training out here? Like, or what's your training regimen like?
Well, yeah, obviously riding. I'll try and do 4 days roughly. Mm-hmm. And then I've got my cycle bike here. So I cycle. Obviously, I was going to the gym when that was open. But that being closed, just been doing circuits and stuff at home. But lately, I've just been doing a lot of running, just trying to get as fit as I can, because running seems to
kick me. It's the fastest way, huh?
Oh, it kicks me in the butt. So
I take it you have good knees and ankles then.
Surprisingly, like, I broke both my femurs, so my hips kind of, they get a little bit flogged out, but my ankles and knees, they kind of cough it well.
Yeah. All right. What are, like, sometimes when I'd hang out with Hunter, like, we used to ride mountain bikes a little bit, he would say some words and I'd be like, what? Like, you guys have a little bit of slang. That even different slang than, you know, Hollywood has, right?
Yeah.
So, like,
we kind of abbreviate everything. So we just put everything short and maybe even throw like an O on the end of it. So, like, isolation at home is just ISO, and like, just, I don't know, and we say A at the end of everything. And I don't know, like, even the family that we're staying with, when my brother and I start, you know, we find something funny and we're laughing at it, we kind of get into this little thing and we're talking and they're just sitting at us, staring at us like, what are these two saying?
Because we're just, when you speak fast.
Yeah, we start speaking fast and we're just throwing these words out and they're just looking at us like, what are these guys talking about? But I've been here for 6 months, so I don't know, I kind of forget what's happening.
Do you think your accent is changing at all being here? Like, when you talk to people at home, do they say, oh, you sound like an American?
No, they don't say anything, but when I hear them talk, it's like, oh, we do sound a little bit different, don't we?
Yeah.
Because, like, obviously hearing all the Americans talk all the time, so when Mum calls me and Dad calls me, I'm like, oh, that's what I sound like.
Okay, so you did the first 6 rounds, I think, thinking about it. So you haven't really seen much outside of California, like Phoenix.
Yeah.
What's been the coolest place you visited?
Well, when we flew to Oakland, we flew in the day before and we went to San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
So that was cool. We cruised around there and we got to go and do Alcatraz. And
oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was cool. So I've always wanted to do that. And yeah, that's a pretty surreal place. So yeah, that was cool. And obviously San Fran was cool. And then Oakland, we had a good night. So it's probably been my favorite place at the moment. And that's not saying much, Oakland.
Yeah. It's funny because we were all in Oakland right around the time just before the pandemic busted out, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, so I was shaking hands and not washing my hands afterwards and stuff. And I'm like, God, we got lucky.
Yeah.
Getting out of there, because I think Frisco and the Bay Area is like a huge concentration of all that.
Yeah, it was crazy. Because I remember, obviously, when we were, you know, sitting there in our break and obviously just starting to hear about this whole coronavirus stuff. I remember San Francisco was real bad and, you know, they went into lockdown first. And, you know, obviously we followed a little bit later. So. It's crazy to think that, you know, we've kind of been stuck in quarantine and isolation ever since. But
yeah,
it's just obviously a crazy time, and I just hope we can get through it. And, you know, Australia's been pretty fortunate. So we've we haven't had as many cases as the US. So yeah. It's cool that, you know, our family's been safe and stuff like that. So obviously I'd like to see America get a little bit better, and hopefully, you know, we don't see much more.
Yeah. All right, so last question. There's a plan to finish the remaining races. What will you be happy with in the last four rounds?
Look, it's these last four is I'm just looking forward to getting back out there. Look, I you know, finished off the last two a lot better than where we started, and started to get more comfortable and just started to figure things out. So obviously this, you know, it's a lot longer than a 6-week break now, but obviously this break has been really good. You know, I've had some time off because I was gone for so long. I think it was about 2 years that I was training for, because our series ended and I come straight over here. So yeah, I've had a little bit of time off and kind of refreshed, and we've got our bike a lot better now. So look, I want to be consistent in the top five, and I want to be on the podium too. So that's kind of where I've got my goal set, to be on the podium and just fighting for some heat race wins, and just keep, you know, showing my face, and just finish it off with a bang.
Nice. Awesome. Well, hey, buddy, thanks for coming in today. Sorry about the time mix up, but glad to have you on the show, and look forward to cheering for you the next time racing starts.
Appreciate it, guys. Thank you.
All right. Thanks for watching, guys. Be sure to check out swapmotolive.com, and we will see you next week.